to start. We'll talk about code or whatever we'll talk about today. It's about to start, so please hang tight while I check that everything is okay. Sound check, camera check, lights check. How's my hair? Oh, wait, I don't have any hair. Maybe put some pants on and I am good to go. So get ready wherever you are, 'cause this stream is about to start. Get ready wherever you are, 'cause this stream is about to start.
Hello, everybody. How's it going? Yeah, we're here. We're data bending. What are you gonna do? We started a little early. Sorry about that. We thought I have website problems. Turns out I have mental problems. All right. Hey, Leandro, how you doing? Am I looking in the right direction?
Hello, yes. Are you?
All right.
The funniest thing is that right in the beginning, the Skype call just froze. So for like 10 seconds, you were just frozen. Technical difficulties from the get-go.
Well, I guess they...
Hey.
Yeah, what are you going to do? It's showbiz, baby. But my audio was there, I'm assuming.
Yes.
Okay. And I'm in a bit of a dark dungeon today, so just ignore that, you know?
I think it will add to the thing we are doing today.
Exactly. Very data mushy environment right here.
Yeah. Right. So, since last time, I learned a bunch about data bending. Do you want to know what I learned?
Okay, great. Sure,
I did what one is supposed to do. I sat down and I read the freaking manual for FFmpeg. It is a long manual.
Oh, wow.
But it is great. I mean,
okay.
Overall, my impression is that it's a very well-designed command line tool, but it is a bit scary because it is giving you a lot of power. So there are good defaults, but still, you probably want to tweak lots of knobs, and then the commands end up looking scary. And you can see historical cruft in the command line interface. You can see that it is an old project, like it is. And in some cases, the thing is inconsistent. And in fact, we bumped into an inconsistency last time. We were trying to use a different pixel format. Instead of YUV, we were trying to use RGB because RGB tends to be more intuitive. Mm-hmm. And we couldn't get RGB. And that was because of one of the command line flags for reading a file. It is pixel format spelled out. And for writing a file, it is pixfmt. Shorthand. So like that, there are 1,000 little inconsistencies, and the deeper you get into the thing, the more you find the dusty corners. But overall, it's very well designed, and as long as you understand the basics of what is a container, what is a bitstream format, and what are the multiplexers and demultiplexers or muxers and demuxers that put streams into a container, and the encoders and decoders or codecs that generate and read the bitstream. As long as you understand all those pieces, you can make sense of the command line interface relatively straightforwardly. It is a good read for one or two nights, and you will figure it out. So,
okay.
With all of that work, I came up with this, the cheat sheet for data bending using FFmpeg. And the reason why I think FFmpeg is the best tool for this is that it can generate raw streams of audio and video if you want. And some of these lines are going to look familiar and some are not going to look familiar. But I thought we should go over all of them and we should actually experiment with them. So, and I guess we are doing this on the command line, but if you know the principles, you should be able to use some graphical user interface on top of FFmpeg, as long as you understand everything that is going on and as long as these tools don't hide away some of the advanced things you can do with FFmpeg. So I guess this one is kind of familiar, but some of the arguments are a bit different. Of course, it's the low-level details here, and no one is going to remember the exact command line flags we used 2 weeks ago, but this is just ever so slightly different. So it is going to call FFmpeg on the command line. It is going to let FFmpeg overwrite any file that it generates. So if we run this command over and over, input.raw, which is the output, incidentally, will be overwritten without asking. Otherwise, it will ask you to confirm. And then it reads any input file.
Is there a code to make it increment? So it'd be like input raw, input 01 raw, input 02 raw.
Good point. No, not that I remember. You would have to write some code around this to check. But maybe, maybe. I don't think I remember seeing that, but maybe. Then it receives an input file, and I was looking at the kinds of formats and the kinds of encoded bit streams that it can handle. And let me show you some of these because they're amazing. In your FFmpeg installation, you can run the help command, and that's going to give you some of the most important flags. And these are going to list the available formats, multiplexers, demultiplexers, decoders and encoders, or codecs in general. And then let's look at the formats. So a format is a container, like MP4 is a container, MKV is a container. And the container may contain streams of audio and video, subtitles, attachments like thumbnails for a file browser. When you see a little thumbnail for a file in Finder, for instance, it can be an attachment in the container. So all of that is in the container, and you can see all the containers that you have available depending on how FFmpeg was compiled, depending on how how you did all this configuration when compiling. So all the libraries that you enabled, many of them are optional. So that's why you can refer to the documentation on the website, but the list there may not be accurate. It may not represent what you have on your machine because...
Like you may not have all this stuff.
Yeah. So you can come here and look at all the formats, but it is nicer to see the formats that you actually have available on your installation. And some of these are amazing. Like you can imagine that you find MP4 somewhere in here, like MP4 and MOV.
Yeah.
You will also find those are pretty standard. And you will also find your MKVs in there. But you will...
What are those D and E's mean?
Yeah, so D means that it's able to decode. So it's able to read that kind of file.
Okay, decode and code. Okay.
And E means that it's able to produce that kind of file. And
Nice.
You will find some formats that are so arcane. And in many cases, you can only read
that
those formats.
That it can only dig. Yeah.
But... Some like
I mean, all
for,
the ones with D on them, right?
Yeah, all like the ones with D you can
A-P-E,
read.
APE, Jesus Christ, what the hell is that? Yeah.
So there are many game engines with custom audio and video formats that FFmpeg can read and in some cases even produce. Like Lego Racers kind of
crazy
stuff. It's just
crazy.
Stuff from way back in digital technology. And it is amazing that these things are here. There is actually a whole library for retro gaming formats for audio and video that you can enable in FFmpeg. And you get stuff like this. And Argonaut games. And yeah, it's just amazing. So anyway, it will be able to ingest pretty much anything you throw at it. But then we want to produce a file that has no metadata. And that's what we saw last time. So raw video in this size and this resolution and this pixel format. And here I am using RGB 24, which means it's going to be using 24 bits or 3 bytes. 1 byte has 8 bits. So overall, 24 bits make up 3 bytes. One for R, one for G, one for B. So it's probably the most straightforward way of encoding a pixel. You let each pixel be 3 numbers, 3 bytes for R, G, and B. And each of these are go between 0 and 255. And
yeah,
you can also use this that we used last time. Or again, you can go to FFmpeg help and find all the pixel formats that FFmpeg can support. And it's not the case that every container can contain every kind of codec. And it's not the case that every codec can contain any kind of pixel format.
Right.
But here are the pixel formats that we can play with. And some of them are straightforward, like RGB24 and RGBH, and even YUV. But some of them are specific to some of the wacky formats that FFmpeg supports. But since we are data bending, we don't really care. Sometimes using something wacky is going to give good results.
Yeah.
Right. So let's put this to action again.
Like, I mean, I guess we never confirmed this, or we never really found the pattern. But like some of those pixel formats have 16 bits or have 24 bits. It's like, is that good? Because then audio in 24 bits, like the bits will line up, but they never line up perfectly. So,
yeah. In fact, when I was playing around with this, I learned that when I was using RGB24, it was more intuitive what was going to happen. Because in many cases, we have these ideas like, oh, if we do this, then the image is going to get brighter or something like that. And in many cases, YUV, it didn't happen. But with RGB, it sort of happens, which means it is more predictable in a way, but it is also more boring in some cases.
Mm-hmm.
And because we are going to data bend, we can always write a file in RGB24 and read it in a wacky pixel format, and something cool will happen. But anyway, let's have
Sounds like a plan.
Yeah, let's generate some input for this data bending session. I thought that maybe we could start taking this more seriously and try to record some footage for the actual musical video that we want to do. How about that?
Yeah, I think like basically every time we like something, even a little bit, we can like rename the output file and then collect all of them.
Yeah.
And then we can even at maybe next stream or whatever, we can talk about video editing in Reaper. Because I've learned some cool stuff. I'm doing a lot of 2D animation in Reaper, and it takes absolutely ages, and I'm sure there's like a really easy and free program that does it easier. But I'm stubborn and Reaper is very fast. So I'm just going to keep using Reaper.
It is amazing to me that you are really doing animation in Reaper.
Yeah, I guess Reaper and GIMP. So I make a little something in GIMP. I bring it into Reaper and then I animate it.
Cool. And scary. Right. So I have here a folder in which I was playing around, and I'm not sure if I should keep any of this. So what I'm going to do
is... Yeah, keep them.
I'm going to keep it around, but I am not going to use this folder for this thing we are about to start. So I'm going to create a new folder here, show your face. I'll copy the cheat sheet there so we have it. And
I had a question, by the way, too. So, and I don't know, I'm sure it is possible, but if it's like going to be a considerable amount of work, forget about it. Like, is there a way in the file for it to, like, remember, like, we were applying filters and stuff, right?
Yeah.
Is it a way for it to kind of, like, put something in the name of the file so that we remember?
Yeah, like not with what? FFmpeg. I don't think that FFmpeg can do that, but we can write some code around the invocation, around the place where we call FFmpeg, and then we can create file names that describe what went into the process of creating the thing. And I will be more careful this time about storing the experiments and categorizing them.
Yeah, we can even just do it manually, right? Like we can just kind of try to remember like what we did resulted in what, so that,
Right. So I think that maybe what we need is some footage. I think that maybe what we need is for you, because you sang the thing, we switch to your camera, and you dub some of the lyrics of the song, and I record that. How about that?
That's a good idea. I mean, I was going to say we can always go to the stream and just get the real one, but it'll probably take us too long. So, okay, let's try. And, like, I don't need to be super accurate because of... Because we're going to, like, mosh the hell out of it, right?
Correct.
Okay, good. All right, sounds like a plan. For some reason, I thought I'm going to use this. It looks more performance-y. And I can cop it just to really piss off audio engineers. Ooh, don't cup the mic.
Do you want me to play the song so that everyone on the stream and everything can hear the song?
Sure, yeah, sounds good.
All right, so take it away.
Wait, hold on. Give me 1 second. I'm thinking my background is underwhelming, you know what I mean? Like, really to get a performance, but okay, I'll try. All right, let's go.
Use your ears. Show your face. Use your eyes.
This was great.
Okay. I hope somebody came on the stream just in this moment with no context. All right.
Here is the video we just recorded. I'm going to get the MP4 version of this. And I think that I also need to do some B-roll for this because I played the melodica. So now let's take care of that.
And your black background always works really well for the videos.
True. In some cases, it works well.
It gives us like...
In some cases, it is a bit too boring because it's just a bunch of zeros that I'm multiplying, for instance. So multiplying by zero is not that interesting. Mm-hmm. But in many of the audio effects that we are about to apply when we get to the next part, for many of them, it is nice to have black because then you just see my face just transforming. All right. So I don't think I need to perform the whole thing, but... Here is the melodica.
Oh, thank you, Glitchy Harvey, for your donation. That's a first for us. That's nice.
Thank you.
I also
played the ukulele. I forgot about comment. That.
Mm. Also, hey, Bo. Hey, Mage. Hey, Glitchy Harvey. Thanks again. Hey, Arrow. Sorry, we sometimes forget the chat, but I'm going to pop it out. I'm going to put it next to Skype. And then what are you going to do? You're going to have it all day. You're going to be looking at the chat.
All right. So it's my turn. I'm going to play the instruments that I played on the original.
Cool.
And let me double check. Yes, I am recording.
Actually something we should record too. I love how the OBS, you know, when you switch to it, it like creates this like slow infinite mirror effect.
It is a Drawsy effect, isn't it?
Yeah.
All right. So it is recording and this is my face. I'm going to show my face. And I need to start the playback for the thing.
Use your ears. Show your face. Use your eyes.
Will do.
Nice. That was a good performance.
Thank you.
I actually have a tear in my eye.
And this is what we have in the can. And I think that we need to cut some of this because it is possible to call FFmpeg on the command line and just take a segment out of the video, of course, because FFmpeg can do anything, but it is much more convenient to pre-cut stuff and then just feed FFmpeg the juicy bits. I think that maybe you have this idea originally in which you wanted to have a cramping EQ and that sort of thing. Do you want to record that?
Oh, sure, we can do that, yeah.
Okay.
Why not? All nice raw material.
So for that, I will use re-Q. And this is a good old cramping EQ. And I can either
put the phase in there. Show your phase.
I see what you did there. Right. So I can either record the whole screen using OBS or I can just record this portion. I think that recording just this portion makes more sense.
I think, record that portion, but just for extra visual interest, can you, like, I don't know, play some white noise or something through it, and you can disable the master synth just so we get, like, some extra movement in the video?
Good point. And let's feed... let's feed the song. Let's feed the song into this. So input...
right, I guess, yeah.
Let's do stereo and then get audio coming from the computer. And then I should be able to play the song. And as I play the song, I will start recording the thing and I will stop talking because it will be loud.
Use your ears. Show your face. Use your eyes.
Think that should be good.
That's good, yeah.
And we got that one in the bag. I think that's all, right? Let's not make this more complicated. We have been here for 1 month already.
Yeah, no, good raw material, and then, yeah, well, we got enough to work with for sure.
And now I think what we need to do is cut some pieces that we like and data bend them.
Mm-hmm.
Or...
sure.
We could try and data bend the whole thing, but I think it would... so here's the thing.
Take probably a long time to render, right?
Yeah. The files are going to be huge. So I think that there are two ways of going about this. We can either just data bend the whole file every time, and then we will end up with a terabyte worth of data.
Tons of stuff.
Yeah. And it will take a bit longer, but it will be just... bam, 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 bam. Or we can start cutting and then data-bending each part.
I have a suggestion. So one thing we can do is cut a small piece, and then every time, like, we find an effect that we really like, that's really working well, we can then just run our, like, full video just through that one time.
Fair. Okay.
You know, yeah.
So for that, I will give lossless cut another try. Though I'm
on lossless cut, let's see.
Yeah, I don't know how to use it all that well. And last time it kind of glitched on me.
So now that you've read the manual for FFmpeg, does FFmpeg has like trim, but otherwise like pass through the format and everything
absolutely
else?
Yes,
like trim the file.
It even gives you control over things like trim to the closest iframe or create a new iframe. It can do everything in it.
That's incredible.
Yeah,
nice.
The problem with that is that
somebody put an interface on that
and like many people did, but the problem is that to use it on the command line like we are about to, it's good because we will be able to automate some things, we will be able to script some things if we find it useful. The bad thing is that whenever you need to give a timestamp in a video, for instance, it gets a bit odd. It isn't ergonomic to do that. And that's why I am bringing lossless cut into the equation. Let's start with you, because I think you should be the main, the A role, so to speak.
My A row wasn't perfectly synced. I think you were actually better synced.
Yeah, but that's all
right. You know what I mean? Sometimes I miss the word.
That's all right. Let's just find a place where you are doing something interesting and we'll cut to test. Do you have a preference? Do you know, like, oh, I liked that part?
Well, like in the end, as I was moving the light, maybe that's going to be a lot of different color things happening, and maybe mushing that will give us a lot of, it'll just give us a lot of flavor.
So I'm going to start here. And we don't want too much data because otherwise things get out of hand. It gets too big and whatnot. So how about there? That is a segment of 5 seconds, it seems.
Cool.
And then I don't want to keep the audio, discard the audio, and then export. Some cue points, maybe in acreage. I'm not sure what you mean by that, but close.
You recorded 24 frames per second?
25.
Oh, that's right. Europe. Ha.
Yeah, my lights here are running at 50 hertz.
50 hertz, yeah. Interesting.
Because it's connected to the power grid, so my camera is running at 25 frames per second. And we have a file. We have a file here.
All right.
And I will call this input because then all my commands on my cheat sheet are just going to work. So that is the command that I showed before, and we can just run it. And it will produce an input.raw file that is 1 gigabyte. And this one. This icon doesn't make any sense. This icon, I think, is from LT Spice, from when we were doing some physical modeling. But that's not what we're doing today. So this raw extension is not really associated with anything. But it is just the R, G, and B values for each pixel from left to right, top down, one frame to the next. And this is what it looks like on a hex editor, if I can open it.
Mage says the arrow should be the one that has the most followers on OnlyFans. Well, I don't have one, so Leander, if you have one, you have more than me. But I'd be surprised if Leander was like, oh yeah, onlyfans.com/LeahFack. Check it out.
No. But I must admit that there was this one occasion, let's not get into the specifics, but there was this one occasion in which I was worried that maybe I would get a copyright claim or something on my video for reasons that I don't want to get into. I didn't, of course, infringe any copyright, but I was thinking, YouTube is not the best when it comes to dealing with these kinds of things. And back then, I wasn't even in the partner program. It was only last week or something, or 2 weeks ago, that I finally got into the partner program because I finally got the...
Oh, hell yeah. I didn't know that. That's amazing.
Yeah. So back then, I wasn't even in the partner program, so I knew that if a copyright claim was going to come, I was going to lose. And I thought, you know what I could do? You know what I could do? I could just stream on porn websites because I don't think they give a heck about copyright. So I can do anything
that's
I want
true,
there.
That's true, yeah.
But I didn't have to. Luckily, I didn't have to.
I would say so far with YouTube, every copyright claim they made on me, I disputed. And they were like, all right, cool.
Yeah, I'm not even sure how the dispute works. Of course, I didn't ever receive a copyright claim. But I'm sure that if there is like a channel that is not even in the partner program and another channel that is much bigger, the bigger channel is probably just going to win. Anyway, let's not get into the politics of that right now. So this is what the file looks like, which of course, as you can see, is a bunch of RGB values. It makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? Next on the cheat sheet is a way just to double check that we can play this file and that it still shows as the original thing. In other words, we didn't mess with the file. We didn't break the file in the process. And it appears that we did, because I didn't provide the correct format.
Oh,
all of these formats are for vertical videos. I need to change them.
Okay.
and naturally I need to reconverge. So that's why I put the minus y thing here, so I don't have to keep saying yes. And now we will try to play the input file. And there you go. We didn't mess it with anything.
Cool.
It's still playing just fine. And of course, we can always play around with the parameters. So what if we interpret RGB as if it was YUV 420p? This is what it looks like.
420. Interesting. Zooms in and gets all weird.
And I guess it zooms in because the size of a pixel is 24 bits in this format, and it is 12 bits in YUV. But the other transformations that we did last time when playing around with this to hold, if I lower the frame rate, it plays in slow motion. And if I increase the frame rate, it plays faster. And if I keep the frame rate and change the height, it will start scrolling across.
Which is fun, always fun.
And if I change the line width, then we get something just broken like this.
Nice.
Which is not too bad. It's not too bad. I don't hate it.
It's pretty cool.
And then we have a raw file. We can treat this raw file, which is a stream of pixels, as if it was a stream of audio. And
last time we
used SOX, which is a command line tool to apply audio effects. But it also happens that FFmpeg has many audio effects. It calls it audio filters. And
nice.
I think that it's nice to use a single tool because it's just one set of flags to set. Yeah. And in some cases, SOX was giving us some grief, like the documentation didn't match what we saw on the command line. And FFmpeg is much better in this aspect. And there are more effects in FFmpeg than in SOX. And some of the nicest things about SOX, like the algorithm for doing sample rate conversion, is really good in SOX. And people who want to get nerdy about this should go to the sample rate conversion infinitewave.ca. And then here you can compare things like how does SOX... So there are different settings, but how does SOX high quality linear phase compared to the Reaper sync interpolation from Reaper 6. Now there is the brain, RH brain. These are also there if you want. And then you can compare. Like
super cool.
I don't see any aliasing in either. I mean, the line here is very faint, and this line here is very faint. So the sample rate converter in SOX is really good. So what the FFmpeg people did is they imported the SOX library that does this, and then you can use it here. So if you go to the documentation for filters, you see that there is a bunch of stuff that we played around with last time that comes from SOX. Like the sample rate converter, I know, comes from SOX. Or at least one
Hello,
option. Maybe
40s.
There are multiple.
Nice to see you.
So with that, we can play around with pretty much anything from SOX and all this stuff in FFmpeg as well. So one of the ones we liked last time is tremolo. Let's start with that.
Yeah,
so
let's give that
let's
a go.
Dissect this command line. I am going to call FFmpeg, tell it to overwrite any output file if it needs to. The format that we produced was raw video. But the format that we are going to interpret the file as is ALAW. And again, you can refer to FFmpeg formats to see all your options. But ALAW is just raw PCM audio using the ALAW that we saw in previous streams. You also have access to MuLAW if you want to use that, or if you want to use the higher bit depths in PCM audio, You can do that as well with things like all these options. And these are looking kind of familiar. Once we learned all the Audacity options for importing raw files as audio, these kind of look familiar. There is the option of big endian or little endian and 16-bit or 24-bit or 32-bit, that kind of thing that we saw in that import menu in Audacity. Do you remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Fotis is saying in the filters documentation is a flag for Fray 0R filters, video effects built in. Oh, cool. Okay, so there's video effects and there's audio effects.
Yes.
In
so,
the old FFmpeg.
Yeah, FFmpeg nice. Can do audio filters, and we are going to do audio filters for video, but we can and we should and we will also convert the song into video. We are going to interpret
video,
the bytes
nice.
Of the song, of the WAV file, as video and watch that and apply some video effects to audio, because you can also do video filters.
Fine.
And then I played around with this already, and I mean, there are effects that just are named awesomely, and sometimes it sounds like distortion, sometimes it just chops the audio in weird ways. It is a lot of fun to do this. So we'll do that as well.
Fine.
But let's dissect this line. So the format, I'm going with ALAW because every data binging tutorial recommends MuLAW or ALAW, but they also recommend AVI instead of RAW files. So what do they know, right? And this is the sampling rate. This is the number of channels. None of these have to be like this. I could pretend that these are two channels, a stereo file. I could change the sampling rate to 96 kilohertz. It doesn't matter because we are not even putting an audio file through this, right? Then the input file. And then the filter. So AF is for audio filter. And this is one of the audio filters from FFmpeg, the tremolo. And I am just applying one effect, but you can apply many. And if you go with a different command line flag instead of AF, if you use filter complex, you can do even chains of filters that go in parallel, then merge, then split.
Nice.
Then, yeah, there is a whole syntax. There is a sub-language for specifying these filters. And there is even this website that lets you click and drag and use a graphical interface to make...
And then generate.
Yeah. I forget the name of the website, though. You have to Google this one if you're interested. But for data binging, I find that just applying one or...
One
maybe
at a
two?
Time.
Yeah, it's probably good enough because it gets out of hand so fast anyway. And then here are the options for the output. And I am using the same options as the input, but I don't have to. I could pretend that the input is mono and the output is stereo or something like that, which is in some cases necessary depending on the filter you want to use. Some filters require stereo input, mono output, or vice versa, and I just have to read the documentation for the filter to learn what you have to do. But in any case, this works. And then this lets us see the result. Not bad.
Very nice. Yeah, pretty cool.
And the conversion was a bit slow, so I do want to check the file size. Yeah, it is 1 gigabyte in and out. That's how long my computer takes to process 1 gigabyte worth of data when I'm streaming and everything. Then finally, let's say that we liked this. So we were able to play this with FFFplay. The settings are sort of... we already covered this. And note, again, pay attention to this. Last time what we got wrong was we were playing files using pixel format, and then we tried to use pixel format here, and that didn't work. So that's one of the dirty little dark corners of FFmpeg. These settings are PixFMT, and this is pixel format, so you have to really read the documentation and pay attention to the details, because here you specify the frame rate with R and here with frame rate, that sort of thing. So,
hello, CBC voter.
To be more specific, these are output settings, and these are settings that are not even input settings. They actually apply to the decoder.
There's playback setting.
Yep. Yeah. So the raw video is both a decoder and an encoder. And when you're using it in decoder mode, you have to use these flags. When you're using it in encoder mode, you have to use these flags. And in the documentation, you will see that the documentation for codecs, codec stands for encoder, decoder. So codecs, they list raw video as encoder and then list it again as decoder. Oh, they list it as decoder and then they list it again as encoder, but it seems like I'm in the wrong part of the documentation. It should be on muxers and demuxers. So it lists raw video as a demuxer and also as a muxer in this part of the doc. So when you're using it as a decoder or as a demuxer, you have to specify this command line flags. When you're using raw video as a muxer, you don't have any special command line flags. You just use the ones that you generally use in FFmpeg. That's how you navigate this weird corner of FFmpeg. But the good thing is that for the most part, any flag you can use with FFplay, you can also use with FFmpeg. So I can just take the exact settings I used to play back, and I can pass that to FFmpeg. So I say FFmpeg, overwrite any file, use these exact settings that I used to play. Now use that to interpret the file for conversion. And then I can use the settings that I used above for size and frame rate and produce an MP4. And I guess this is the time when we name things. So aria tremolo, for instance. And in my experience, it's not always the case that every player can play the generated files, which is a bit unfortunate, but I found that at least Reaper can play anything that comes out of FFmpeg. So here is aria tremolo MP4. And if I try to preview it with quick play, yeah, it complains. But let's try VLC.
QuickTime can
Yeah, VLC can play this.
QuickTime, you weak. Yeah. QuickTime, get with it. You suck.
So now we saw the whole process of going from video back to video. We can drop this in the Reaper timeline, and in my experience, it works. But do you want to do the other side of the equation? Take the song and turn it into video and watch it?
Hell yeah, let's do that.
Yeah, so for that, I'm going to call FFmpeg, override the output, and then I'm going to take as input the input.wav file, which I already renamed and everything, and the input.wav file is... There you go. The input.wav file is the song. And then I... again, can interpret this as a law, mu law, anything, but I'm just going with the same settings as before. And I forgot to explain this flag and this flag. So this is just saying, don't try to output any audio, which of course it would not, because in this format, this is a kind of container that cannot contain audio. But just to make sure, I'm saying don't put any audio out. And same here. Don't try to put any video out because this is a raw file of audio. And again, this is a kind of container, a kind of format that cannot hold videos. So it would not by default. But just to be sure, I'm putting the VN, which turns off video. So with that, now we have an audio file that is this dot raw file now. Let's see what it looks like in a hex editor. Of course, here it is, a bunch of D5s. Looks like our song. Now it's a bunch of D4s, D7s. Makes a lot of sense to me. Looks like my audio file.
Yeah, that looks like a cramped EQ right there. Those.
I was thinking exactly that. Now let's go to FF Play and try to play this input raw file we generated using the same settings. So we should hear the song.
Use your ears. Show your face. Use your eyes.
And we do hear...
Nice.
Do you hear the song? I just want to make sure that my audio routing is working correctly.
Yes.
Awesome. And it's kind of nice. In FF Play, there are all this... It's in the manual for FF Play or the documentation here on the website for FF Play. But there are all this... ways to interact. You can loop, you can change the visualization from a spectrograph like this into a waveform. You can change from this into that, and you can see it's crazy. You seek by right clicking on the file or on the window. Right, so we didn't destroy anything. We kind of lost quality because we downsampled and we are using 8 bits. For the most part, we cannot hear a difference. And now we can use video filters to process audio files. But we can also try to watch this. So let's try and watch this. I'm going to use...
Yeah, let's first with watch it just without anything apply.
Yeah, so this is the way we can see raw... video, and I think that if I just play it like this, it's going to be very short because previously our video file was 1 gigabyte and our audio file now is, 3.5 megabytes. So I think it's going to scroll by too fast.
It's like less than a frame, yeah.
So to remedy that, how about we lower the frame rate and we decrease the video size as well?
Yeah.
And this is what our song looks like.
Sick.
Now, when I was experimenting with this, I found that this pixel format is not the best because it just looks like black and white. But in other pixel formats, we get more interesting things. Like this is more, it's still going to look like white noise, but it's going to be a bit more colorful.
Nice.
And this was actually my favorite use case for the wacky pixel formats. Not fix, but pix. And actually, let's put this on a buffer. So pb copy and paste. So now we have a list here that we can play with. So do you care to pick a value you like?
Yeah, I want to go with something super low, like a 12-bit. Yeah, like let's go with RGB 444LE. So that we got more frames.
And do you know what the LE stands for?
Totally.
Little Endian.
Oh, damn. I was pretending like I know. Hey, it's like jeans or something.
Let's try something that we don't recognize. Mmol?
QS.
Oh, but that is, there is no IO for that. It only knows how to, well, it's a hardware accelerated thing, but it doesn't do IO. That's weird.
Annoying. What else?
This sounds odd, and it uses 36 bits per pixel. That's crazy.
That's
Oh, I don't hate this.
Hey, that's kind of cute. Yeah, that's pretty nice.
It is
nice
less
colors.
Line-ish and more blockish. And when we make this bigger, it really looks cool.
That's cool. I like that. Oh, in the end, did you see what happened? Like, as it went towards silence, I would have guessed that it would tend towards blackness, but it tended towards whiteness.
And in the beginning of the song, here I am. Let me pause and seek to the beginning. You can see the beginning of the song is silent. This is what silence looks like in this pixel format. And this is what silence looks like
it's
on the
tail.
It's
very cool, like... This is like a good color palette for branding, you know, like these pixels, they kind of nicely work together. I like it.
So I think that we should take this and also have that in the video. So let's produce a file that is an MP4 that of the thing we just saw. So for that, what we want is to convert from raw video into video. It's not really video, but we are going to interpret that as video. And we are going to take this command line. And in this case, we want to run this format as the input. And in this case, we are actually looking at the unmodified input. We didn't even filter this yet. So this is what we use on FFPlay to play this file. And now we can decide on the settings to output. And I think it would be nice to preserve this aspect ratio and maybe 5 frames per second to try and get something usable out of this, because otherwise it's going to scroll by too fast.
Yeah.
Or...
Oh, you made it too.
No, yeah, I was thinking
about
this.
I mean, you could scroll by fast, then you can loop it.
No. I think that FFmpeg is going to interpret the input at 5 frames per second, and it's going to produce the output at 25 frames per second, which is what we want. I think it's just going to copy and paste the same frame 5 times on the output.
Yeah.
But then it's going to encode everything in an MP4, and it's going to make our editing cells happier. So I think that this is the line I want to run.
Maybe name it something meaningful, but it's okay.
Oh, yeah. Good point.
We can name it in post.
Now, I'm just going to wait for this to finish, and then I'm going to... Oh, see? This time it's really struggling. I'm not sure you can see this, but it is processing this at way less than real time.
Oh, at 0.1. Well, I mean, you know, like rendering in Reaper takes some time, so maybe it's because the size needs to change, the aspect ratio needs to change.
Yeah. Oh, this is good. Sorry. This is good. This actually means that we are about to finish. Because... Nice. What this is saying is I was interpreting all of these frames, and then I got to the end and I couldn't get a full frame.
Mm-hmm.
See what I mean?
Drops it, right?
Yep. I was expecting to get this much. Sorry. I was expecting to get this much for a frame, and I couldn't get it.
60,000. Cool. It's okay, FFmpeg. We forgive you.
So with that, let's see what it looks like in VLC and rename it. So this is going to be like a song as video. And I'm not even going to bother with QuickTime.
Get out of here, QuickTime, with your stupid ass.
Surprise,
that looks great.
Surprisingly, it does not look orange.
Yeah, it's a different color.
It's a different
color. I like it. It kind of looks like pills. It looks like a bunch of pills on an old lady's kitchen counter. Or bacteria. That's what it looks like. It looks like bacteria.
And if I go to the codec details, just to make sure the size is right, the frame rate is right. So it is 25 frames per second, but when I play, it looks like 5 frames per second. So it really did... copy the frame 5 times.
Right. Basically. Mm-hmm.
Okay, nice. Good stuff. So next, let's apply some video processors, video filters to the audio and try to hear the result. So this
sounds fun.
Is the command line in which we filter. And in this case, I think that we were not using RGB. We were using this weird thing. So let's go through this. FFmpeg is going to interpret this as a video file using this pixel format. This is the input. And then it's going to apply a video filter that does erosion. And then it's going to produce an output file using this same interpretation. This looks about right to me. And I suppose it worked. But let's see what came out of this. So I'm going to use the same playback command as before, because that's what we encoded with on the way in. So I'm going to use this, and this is going to be loud, and I am not sure how to lower the volume with FFplay. The best thing I can do... No, I can look up volume real quick in FFplay. Volume. Yeah, okay. Set the startup volume. So probably
okay.
I want to put this like here because it's a global option. And then I have to pass a number. I'm going to pass 10%. Okay, I did my best, but it may be loud.
So trigger warning, everybody, you may be loud.
Maybe loud.
Okay, that covered our asses. Ooh. Wow, crazy. It created this major sixth like interval that wasn't even in our thing. That's
playback.
Cray.
Do you want to play with some
incredible
others? I don't want this stream to be like the last one in which you just spend some time playing around with the filters, but do you want to play around with some other ones? Because I found this.
Let's try a few
video
more.
Effects amazing.
I was really intrigued. Yeah, it's really interesting that it like changed the pitch, but of not everything. There was like that one note that was like a major sixth of itself. I'm just like, how? What?
Yeah. So I invite you, Aria, and everyone else on the chat to go to the FFmpeg filters documentation, this page here. Go to the video filters and find some that look interesting to you. And let's play around with just a couple of these and see what they sound like. Of course, I don't think we will use this in the song. The song is done, but I wanted to play around with this other side of data bending since we are audio people.
Yeah. And I mean, like, what I really want to do, and we can do this, of course, in a later stream or something, is like kind of a similar thing to what we did the video, like start with like a sine wave. And then we can kind of trace what it's doing. But this is also very fun because we may, based on what's like if you start with a sine wave audio, then you can kind of like extrapolate the effect that the video filter is doing. Like, oh, this one is like crushing the, or, you know, this one is causing clipping and a bit of frequency shifting, you know, just.
That's an interesting thought. My intuition tells me that nothing meaningful will come out of this. We will not be able to see like erosion does a sixth or something, because we are taking the bits and we are interpreting them in a bi-dimensional format.
Mm-hmm.
So the sine wave that used to be this one-dimensional thing is being put into a two-dimensional space. I don't think that we'll be able to... And I'm not saying that nothing meaningful will come out of this in the sense that it will not be fun, because I think it will, but in the sense that I think it will be hard for us to pinpoint something like, oh, this looks like a 10H kind of saturation. But,
yeah,
let's play around with some of these. Do you have a preference?
I'm trying to find something that at least I barely have an idea what it is. Like freeze frames. Let's freeze frames.
And the other thing I like about FFmpeg as opposed to SOX is that for all the filters I played with, I didn't play with all of them because there are too many, but with all the ones I played with, all the parameters are optional. So it's much easier to just get a sense of what it does. But anyway, we are now doing freeze frames.
Nice.
Oh, it seems like this is a case where it wants more inputs or more outputs, or actually it expected exactly one input and output, and it had more than one input. To set this up, we would need to use filter complex. So pick another one.
Well, what is that fray 0R? That's what Fortis said. So let's look at that.
And I'm not going to give... I don't know what it is, and I'm not even going to read the documentation. I'm just going to try it.
Yeah, documentation, schmockumentation.
Error reinitializing filters failed to inject frame into filter network. Invalid argument. Okay, another one that maybe we would have to use filter complex or something else. It needs more inputs.
Let's do
a blur.
Have you used one that you part? Sure, blur is easier. I know what that is.
Let's use blur. If that fails, then I will be damned. Okay, so this time it gave us that error saying the frame isn't complete.
Not enough packets stuff.
That's okay. Yeah, that's whatever. Expected. So let's try to hear this.
We don't give a shit about that. Oh. Very noisy and not meaningful. It kind of reminds me, what's that instrument called? Is it a Geiger counter? The thing that measures radiation?
Yeah, I know that.
It sounds like that, but when there's not a lot of radiation.
You know what we didn't play with, and I just forgot about this entirely, is to try and hear the input. But give the wrong arguments. So I'm going to make this louder. But let's try to get a file that is actually a law and interpret that as mu law. Yeah, maybe I should have lowered for this one. Let's do 20. It's a really aggressive distortion, and I guess it makes sense when you think about A-law and mu-law.
Yeah.
They are effectively compressing and expanding the bits, so it makes sense that if you use different curves...
This reminded me of the Compander video of Dan Worrell, where he uses the different settings for the first bit and the second bit.
Yeah. Let's play around with the sample range. If we go double this, which is 88.2, then it should play twice as fast. I suppose.
Yeah.
And if we give it a bad number.
Use your ears. Show your face.
It speeds things kinda... up ever so slightly. I wonder what happens if I tell that this is actually a stereo file. So funny, it's playing twice as fast because it is interpreting the consecutive samples as if they were left and right. So it's playing twice as fast and it's playing half of the samples on one ear and half on the other. So I wonder what happens if I just lower the sample rate. If we'll get some kind of weird stereo effect.
That bit wasn't
effect.
Coming through in the stream. Or at least it's not coming through in the Skype. In Skype, I'm just hearing mono, so I didn't hear that.
Oh, left yeah, yeah, yeah. I couldn't hear any kind of stereo thing happening, but I'm bad at interpreting stereo. But anyway, let's go to 2250 and see if we get any weird stereo effects.
Use your ears.
Wait, no way that was the sample, that was a sample rate of 22,000, was it?
No, it was interpreting this file as 22,000, but then for playback, it was upsampling again, because
The
stream we are running at 44.1, and on Skype, I suppose they're running at 44.1 as well. On my ears, it's running at 48 kilohertz. So it's doing all these sample rate conversions everywhere. But yeah, I mean, this is what we got. And I couldn't hear a lot of difference. It is a bit lower quality, but nothing crazy.
Yeah.
Right.
Is there like a effect, like a sepia effect or something? Let's try something like that and then go back to video two. Go back to video.
Oh, there is a channel
mixer. Or just
mixer.
Black and white, you know, whatever. Hey, I know Blackman and Harris.
Another thing that I think would be fun is to play not with the filters, but with the codecs. What would happen? And I guess then we are starting to get into data moshing territory. What would happen if we ran a video through a codec and tried to watch the raw output as video without decoding?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's just going to be white noise or colored noise. But I think it could be interesting noise. So we saw G blur, and I couldn't really find black and white, but can we try colorize? That should do something.
Sure.
If we saturate to zero, then we should get black and white or grayscale, right?
Right.
But let's just do colorize with default settings to begin with.
Nice.
Isn't it weird that it is rhythmic?
It's rhythmic, yeah. And it's like a little, it's like a pulse and then a bit of a noise, then a bit of a pulse, then a bit of a noise. Now, how can we make it faster?
I have no idea. Color key? That is like a green screen kind of thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let's do a green screen to audio.
Sure. Oh. That first bit sounded awesome.
Yeah. Let's go to the end.
So probably the end will sound awesome too.
No, I think that the jam was the beginning.
The beginning was like a nice foley layer of like a tingly thing, you know. I could totally see that sampled and used in music. Ting, ding, ding. Ah, that's the ticket. I want that. I want that file.
You want that file? Okay, I'll give it to you. Do you want it in like wave? I'll give you a wave for this, okay?
Sure.
So
it'll help.
Let's take raw audio and convert it to audio. We can interpret this in this way and get a wave file out. That looks about right. And then let's see if we can. Okay. Nice. It is a loud file, but here is the file. And I will send it to Aria.
Ting, 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 ting. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention this. Not that we are lacking raw materials, but do you know the band King Gizzard and the Wizard Lizard?
Not really. I think you mentioned it before, but I don't remember.
They're a cool band. So they have some of their songs. Like, they have the multi-tracks, but also, like, raw video files of the music videos. Just, like, on torrents. Like, they put it there. And they are completely, like, free of any copyright. You can do whatever the hell you want to them. Some people are even printing their vinyls for them. And they get the money. Like, King Gizzard doesn't get the money. But anyway, so those videos are, they're kind of, like, fun, weird videos, too. So we'll see. Like, once we get our raw material, if we need extra B-roll and stuff, that's one place to get stuff from.
All right. Nice. Okay, next. I think that we did all the audio stuff. That was quite fun. Mm-hmm. Do you want to return to video?
Yeah, let's do some video stuff.
Okay, so for that, how about we just cut something else? Let's cut something else because we already have an effect one in this part. Let's find some other parts that we like. And as I get my bearings here on, I want to delete this segment, remove selected segments. Okay. I got to make a new segment. Let's find something else.
Yeah, this light flickering bit, I think, could be a fun part to play with.
I want to perhaps get some more of it here. That. And we don't want it to be too long.
Yeah.
Something like this, 7 seconds will do. And discard audio, Aria MP4, export. And this is going to be the new input MP4. And now we have to reconvert into raw, and we have to filter with something. We already did tremolo, so now let's shop for something else. This is the page for filters, and here are the audio filters.
Cool. I keep trying to make
we gotta do echo
delays and echoes happen. Yeah. They never quite happen how I imagined them, but let's give it a go.
Delay one or more audio channels. I think that is like going to...
It's like a stereo delay.
Yeah, I think it's going to delay one channel with respect to the other. So I think we want echo. applying echo to the input audio. That seems like more like what we want. So this goes
like a Haas effect on a video.
And then to play. So I am always producing files. I want to mention this because someone brought it up on chat last time. I am producing files for everything. And I think it is conceptually cleaner to produce files for everything. But if you just are experimenting fast, there is a shorthand. You don't have to produce a file and then watch the file. You can instead do something like this. Take the output of this and send it to the command line. When you put a dash as the name of the file, it means the command line. So if I were to run this on the command line, I would get a lot of garbage on the command line. Let's see if that actually happens. See? Lots of garbage. In fact, if I try to type in the terminal now, there is a chance that it will not work. Well, I guess it worked. But anyway, it outputs the file to the command line. And then on the input of FFPlay, I can receive input from the command line. And that means that I can pipe from one command to the other. And then in one command, I can convert and watch the results.
Nice. Hey, that's pretty cool. This time,
but because
can
we want
watch
to
it one more time, I saw something really cool.
Yeah, I want to do this in my usual way of producing output files because I prefer, because if there is any kind of randomness in the processing and we want to capture that, we can convert to an MP4. But if we just piped into FFPlay, that's gone. So I'm going to produce an output file, play the output file.
Wow, that actually worked pretty well.
That's what you wanted, right? To have two versions of you like that.
Yeah, I have a question though, or not a real question, but a comment, but maybe you agree. It seems like the overall colors are very different from what we get out of FFmpeg. They're like a little darker, more military. Whereas like yesterday when we did, well, I guess we can try it with your video. With your video, when we did Echo, I remember it kind of got greener.
Well, I think that that has to do with RGB 24. Do you want to switch?
Let's try it. Yeah. Yeah, let's try UV. Because the color I was not impressed by this time. It's reporting the speed and E. Oh, yeah, there you go. Nice. Well, I guess we should obviously be using a mixture so we get different colors, but this changed what the echo did too. So it's like a little bit of this.
Let's convert this, and then we have Aria UV 420p. And what we did was echo. And naturally, I have to change this as well. Or not, but I will. Okay, that looks about right. And oh yeah, this is the command that takes a while to run. So while it's doing that, I will come back to this and do RGB 24 so that we have both options in the end.
Mm-hmm.
In this command, I will want to change. To Aria. RGB 24 echo.
This is probably not possible, but it's not possible to like render a bunch of videos, right? Like start rendering one, put another one in, then go like have coffee or something. You know what I mean?
It's absolutely possible, yes. Do you want to write a little program to do this?
No, not necessarily. I was just wondering, because I was like, okay, like if stuff is getting longer,
That is the beauty of doing things on the command line. That's why I am using even the effects on the command line, because we could do something like this to get a wave and then drop that into Audacity or Reaper or whatever. But I'm doing even the filters in the command line so that it is possible to automate this. But I find that experimenting with things is a good way to start. And then once you find things you like we liked Echo, we liked Tremolo, then you could get a lot of footage, get a lot of filters, and produce a massive folder, and then pick from there. Yeah, I think we got enough out of this. Do you want to do the other video?
Sure.
So let's go to the cramping EQ, which is Reaper Mauve. And perhaps we can just get a segment at the end where I was like cramping.
I think the whole thing is good. Yeah. And this one's like a smaller video, so probably it'll take less time to do all the stuff to it. But it is a blacker video, so maybe the results are not going to be like, whoa.
So we got 6 seconds of this. Should be good. There is no audio to discard because I didn't record audio into this. I didn't burn audio into this. I think it should be good. Let's export this. There is a problem that, as you mentioned, this video is a different file, a different dimension, different size. So I will have to take note that these are the dimensions I need to pass on the command line.
Okay.
And this is like now input mov.
Fine.
And I just want to make sure that some bookkeeping I want to do. Hang on. Yeah, I just wanted to make sure my original cheat sheet was there. Because I'm changing things here, so I'm working on a copy in case I mess something up.
Hey, don't go to the Be Right Back page. Just keep going, but I'll be right back.
Okay.
Just keep doing what you're doing.
Yes, I will keep doing what I'm doing. And I am not reading the chat, but I will ask Aria to read the chat later. And again, I'm going to mention this. Filters, go to the FFmpeg page for filters for audio effects and think of audio effects you think would look good on video and mention in the chat, and then we will follow your suggestions. Now instead of MP4, I will do MOV and everything else should be good. And how about we try to listen to this video. What does it sound like? Let's listen to this video. It is the input raw. But what does a cramping EQ sound like? What does the video of a cramping EQ sound like?
Whoa. Very nice. I can totally see stuff like this, like sampled or used as like wavetables, and they'll probably sound pretty interesting.
Yeah, I don't know if you were already back, Aria, but what we are listening is the video of the cramping EQ.
Yeah.
So this is what a cramping EQ sounds like. And now it is time for next effect. And I asked people to suggest in the chat. So if you have suggestions from there or some of your own.
Nobody gave a shit.
So what are your suggestions?
So I want to try just different EQs I feel like is fun. Or bit crushing. I don't know if we tried that. Like if we bit crushed video as audio and then make it video, it'll probably just end up being like blacker and not very interesting.
You never
know. Is what I would guess, but yeah, you know, clearly we never know.
Didn't do anything.
I don't even see any difference. It could be, again, because this video is very black to begin with. I did see that the like light blue areas kind of were interlaced vertically. Maybe that was what happened, but it wasn't remarkable.
Let's try to give it some parameters because we didn't try that yet.
Okay.
What we have to do is set the number of bits. So how about 2.5 bits?
Wow, you're not fucking around.
And this was just because I wanted to show the syntax for passing these arguments. Well, it's crashed.
Oh, there we go. All right. Nice.
But we need to do more to this. So let's keep the bit crusher and pass something else because I want to show how to cascade filters. So we will do first a bit of crushing, and then let's do how about a dynamic EQ?
Sure.
And let's see what just dash does. The dynamic EQ is
slower.
What
would be the default of the dynamic EQ? Like, what's it dynamically EQing by default? Hertz, 1,000 hertz. Cool.
Well, it didn't do anything. But that's all right.
I don't see much. Yeah.
That wasn't too exciting. How about we get an exciter?
Sure, let's make it exciting.
And I guess this time we will have to play with echo or reverb to try and make this a bit more
reverb,
interesting.
Reverb, yeah, I was thinking. Yeah, get more color in there.
Yeah, that did something.
Oh, there we go. That's pretty nice.
And how about we put some reverb? Apply reverb, but then we need some sort of impulse response. And then for this,
well,
we need...
Well, for impulse response, just use the song.
that's too long, but I can cut the song a bit shorter. I'm thinking if there is some other reverb. This needs some VSC, not a VLC, a VSC, but an LADSPA. Oh, and there is no built-in reverb on this. That's too bad.
Wow, they got dynamic EQ, but they don't have like a reverb. Well, let's just use like a delay with a lot of feedback and very short delay time.
Oh, okay, we learned that we actually want echo and we want to...
Like high feedback, low, very short time.
Input, output...
I guess the decay is the feedback. So you can make the decay like 1 and it will never decay. So make it 0.9 and it will be very short.
And we can also play with the time because the time was long.
Yeah. So let's make it really short. Make it like 3 milliseconds or something.
Whoops. I was also editing something here. Let me backtrack a little. Oh. Okay, I know what I need to do. Bear with me. I will copy this.
It's still typing it down there, but I don't think...
There you have it. And...
Okay.
Delays... Oh, hang on. I actually don't know how to separate multiple options. I need to see that here. Oh, hang on. A longer delay will sound like an open-air concert in the mountains. Metallic robot. Twice as many instruments. I like these presets. I want to do this one.
Yeah, let's try them. If you write all the parameters, you don't need to name them individually.
It appears so, yes.
Okay. Yeah. So bit crushed, then excited, then echoed. And also, I wonder, I mean, I'm sure that's the different. Ooh, there we go. That's pretty interesting. You can see a little bit of it like on the side. That's kind of cool. Now, I wonder, I'm sure it will. If we move the order, if we change the order of effects. So if we echoize first and then excite, that way our echo is like louder. And then bit crush or just, yeah, exactly. So, yeah.
And in 2.5 seems too easy. Let's do this.
Okay, sure.
I think I messed it up. Yeah, I think I messed it up. I have to rerun this. I typed stuff while FFmpeg was converging. In the hopes that it would run right after it, but I think it took that as a command, and that I'm not sure how that works. Okay.
All right.
That's pretty mangled. So it even wraps here. Oh, some aliasing going on.
Yeah.
Reflections.
Yeah.
I will take it.
Yeah.
So with that, we can convert that into Reaper. And this has been Echo, Exciter, Crusher. And I guess we could put all of this in the command line or in the file name, but I will not. Okay. Oh, you know what is interesting? No, I was going to say something that was wrong. Okay, do you want to do another one?
Sure. I'll tell you one thing, too. I don't know if you still have those, but remember when you were just using, like, straight JavaScript math to mangle the files, and you took your face, and it was gradually getting kind of, like, weirdly colored? That still remains to be one of my favorite things, so we really should put that in the video. I don't know if you still have it or if we have to remake it, but
I absolutely
I want
have
that
it.
Stuff.
Yes, I absolutely nice. Have it. Let's look at it.
And we can even put some of those videos into our effects, you know, and play with those double dipping, as it were.
Sure. So here is that little program, and the equation here I don't think was that the one that you liked. But let's play around with this. So this is the simple program that just reads the file and writes another file, but it lets us mangle with the bytes in between. And I actually want to share some things that I learned about this. Because when I read files normally, I read text files, but this is not a text file. So in Node.js, now it's reading this as a something called a buffer, just a stream of bytes. And I learned some things about buffers. So let's create a buffer that we have more control over, like a buffer with three number zeros in there. And let's give this a name of hello. And then hello at zero, for instance, is number zero. And I can assign numbers like 32. And then hello at zero is the number 32. Hello is this buffer now. Easy enough. Mm-hmm. What I learned about this that is actually interesting is that it wraps back. So you know how we were using modulo 225 before to make sure that it was between 0 and 225? That's unnecessary, because if I try to assign something like 300, it will internally convert this into 44 in this case, because 300 modulo 225 is, or maybe 226, is 44. So
nice.
The buffer is already doing that internally, and it can even deal with negative numbers. So something like -5 will wrap back and turn into 251.
And
if you try to do anything that is fractional, because we also used math floor before, if you try to do anything that is fractional, like 5.5, it always truncates. So 5.5.
It auto floors.
It auto floors, exactly.
Nice.
So in light of this, we can write some formula that we find interesting. I think that the effect you liked the most, we did on an image, and we were applying the effect over and over and over. But in this case, we have a video. Yeah. So let's do something else instead. How about we add the index to the image, to the byte. Because the effect that will have is to wrap around. This index will get bigger and bigger and bigger. So this will be a number that keeps wrapping around.
Cool.
Or not this, but this will be treated that way.
Right.
So to run this, we will want to node index.mjs. And then for the raw video play, I want to change. Oh, let's get some other input material, because I think that we did enough already with this. Let's do some, like my face. Mm-hmm. How about that?
Sure, yeah. Yeah.
This should do it. 6 seconds. Looks good. Did that work? It was kind of fast. I think it worked. Yeah. Oh, that has audio. Let's discard the audio. Export. Close. What did you do? Oh, you overwrote the file. Awesome. So that's going to be our input MP4. Oh, that's already taken. Input MP4. Get rid of that. Input MP4. And then this takes input and output. Perfect. So we can just run this, and this file has a different resolution. So we are back to full HD. That is still working on the wrong file.
See, yeah.
Because I didn't remember to change this back into MP4.
Nice.
We can see the cycles of the input index, of the index wrapping around.
That's a great effect.
It is.
It almost looks like you're made out of stacks of coins.
Yeah.
Keep it.
So let's skip it.
Keep it.
And I will name this one Leandro Coins, because really, how can we describe what we did there? Nice is that the MP4 conversion is introducing some differences as well. Maybe that's what messed with the color before, and that's definitely something you can see. You can see that the encoder is doing something to the image.
little smushy, yeah.
For one thing, we didn't have these kinds of ripples before.
Those red bits?
Yeah.
Nice.
I'm 90% confident we didn't have them to begin with. I think that that's an artifact of the encoder. Let's watch the raw. Oh, what do I know?
Maybe they got a little more accented.
Yeah, I mean, this definitely looks different.
We should also now use this as raw material and then like put one more effect on top of it.
Oh, you
want to
do this?
I really want to learn. Yeah, like I want to know what we can use to saturate the colors a little bit more. And like, I mean, saturation, like the exciter we're using at the default settings, which may be just really sensible settings. So can we set some really insane settings to the exciter and seeing what happens?
Yes, we can also use video filters for this, you know. If you already kind of have an image for what you're looking for, we could use a video filter.
Right, I guess.
Do you want to try and do that?
I feel like it's a little bit cheating. I feel like I'm trying to control it too much, whereas you just got to embrace what happens in the data, you know what I mean?
So we have the output, and I guess what I'm going to do is the output becomes the input. So I'm going to take output raw and turn that into input raw. And now I can run this line with exciter as you asked. Oh no, no such filter exciter. That's a exciter for audio.
And of course, all of this FFmpeg stuff is non-destructive to the original, right?
Yes. You have inputs and output files that are separate. I guess it would do the right thing if you set the same output file as the input file. It will overwrite with the result, but I don't know. I always use
Hello, Synchrotron.
Files.
What have you missed? We're just moshing stuff. That looks nice.
Let's
see. Pretty
that.
Interesting.
Raw video.
What I find again really interesting is that bits that were the same color ended up being different colors after going through, well, I guess not a linear process. There you go, ship links.
So I'm converting and keeping that. And now let's get something else and do something else to it. But let's keep on the same file because I think that there are more parts that we can.
Yeah, let's do some ukulele bits. I mean, we still, in terms of what we have final result-y, we still have about 25 seconds of video. We need a lot more.
Yeah, I'm thinking that we will want to show some of the raw recordings as well. And then some interspersed with some data bench stuff.
Cool.
And then how do I, if I click on export, is it going to export just this? Well, I will never know.
I don't know if we can do this with FFmpeg. Another thing we did like early on was like we mushed our two videos into one, which sometimes worked well, sometimes it was weird. Can we do something like that with FFmpeg?
Yes. What we want is not necessarily to deal with the videos, but let's convert two videos into audio, then use a filter that mixes the audio, and then go from there. How about that?
Ah, gotcha.
So I have one thing here. So let's take the... let's just convert this. I just want to make sure that I have the ukulele part.
Cool. I like the change of expression. We didn't really catch the full change of expression, but that's okay.
Now, I will take this input and call it input 2 raw. And let's find another slice and... This will do. Cut here. And... There. That's kind of short.
Cool.
Maybe it should be the same
Short's
length.
Short's good. Oh, maybe. Yeah.
But maybe there is a way for us to tell it to loop. It will be hard for me to get exactly the same length, I think.
Yeah, you know, it's experimental, so let's like not even worry about that.
So now I have this, and I will call this the input, and then, oh, the input is already taken. Let's remove this into input, rerun that, and now we have two raw input files. Let's find the ffmpeg command we must use to merge these two. I think it will be something like a mixer. Or a mix. And for this one, we must use filter complex because it will use two input files. So let's work through this step by step by taking the example and see a good example here. Mix three input audio streams to a single output with the same duration as the first input and a drop transition time of 3 seconds. We'll mix one vocal and one music input audio stream to a single output with the same duration as the longest input. The music will have quarter the weight of the vocals, and the inputs are not normalized. Okay, I guess I will take this one. And let's build from here. Or maybe let's build there. So first, for the inputs, we will want to overwrite whatever output file we have. And we will want to have the input twice, not three times, just twice. One of these two is going to be input 2, I think that's how I named it.
2.
Input 2 raw. And then filter complex, a mix inputs 2, duration
equals 2.
The second video I made is shorter, so the second video I made is actually input, so I'll let it be that, and no dropout. And then the output can be output raw. And
cool.
That is what I will want to play.
When you run two commands like that, it'll just run them in series?
Yes.
Like it'll run one and then... I don't see the other video.
Yeah, unable to find a suitable output format for output raw, invalid argument. I think it is because I did not specify all the output stuff that I need to specify. And now I will try that. Okay, now it's taking a little while. That is what we want to see.
Expected.
Oh man.
Whoa, that is pretty good.
It is pretty good.
Also, where they like line up, that's pretty incredible that they lined up like nearly perfectly in a few places. Yeah.
I want to watch that again. I think that this is my magnum opus.
Yeah.
When I sort of intersect, my colors look about right. Because we didn't do anything to the colors.
You know, it wouldn't be like bad necessarily if we had the audio of the original recording so we knew where in the song it goes, but like we can figure that bit out. But yeah, this is a pretty good. And again, I feel like your black background actually really works in this case because there's so much to like work with, you know what I mean?
Well, I do like your background if on some of the stuff screen, we did like 2 weeks ago, I think.
Yeah.
Where your background started to turn into these blocks of color. That was pretty cool too. But this is just pure
you
gold.
You see like the left side, Leandro, like that color is the thing that I want to find the code for again. Where your colors like started going to this black, like thermal heat map kind of situation.
I know exactly what you mean, and I think I know how to get there. So first, we need to keep this because what we have here is just pure gold. This is
pretty good.
An award in our hands here. So this is Leandro on top of itself. Himself? Maybe I am a person. And while it's doing that, how about we grab some of you to do the thing you mentioned? The heat map thing worked better in a dark background. I think I'm going to do it with some other section of me.
Yeah, I think so.
Here I am playing, here I am sort of being goofy with the ukulele. Let's do that before I turn into creepy mode. And about this much. I think that this much.
Oh yeah, we should do one where one bit of the video is you kind of smiling and the other one is the like psycho face.
Input goes away and this turns into input. We convert this into raw and let's go back to the script. So I think that the effect that we had there, what was making that happen was that we
were image.
It was an image, but what we were doing to the image was adding a small number to it, so it was turning brighter, brighter and brighter and brighter, and then as we saw in the command line, the buffer wraps back to zero. And when it does that, it inverts the colors. So I think that that's what we want. So that's why I added the index here. We are adding the index. And that's a number that is going to wrap around real quick and whatnot. But what if we divide the index by a large number? Then in the beginning, this should be a very small number and it should not change the pixel all that much. But as the video progresses, it should add as a bigger and bigger number here. So it will make the effect more pronounced. But I need to pick this as kind of a large number. I guess this number is not even large enough. So maybe this will do, because now it is getting, I guess, no, the maximum will be 1. So let's multiply by like 100. So now this is a number between 0 and 1, and this is going to be a number between 0 and 100, which may give us the effect, or maybe like 200 should give us the effect. We'll see. We'll play around with this. So the conversion is over. I will now run this and that.
Oh, and it's getting whiter. That effect on the t-shirt was pretty cool.
Yeah, I think we can go a bit faster. What do you think?
Yeah. So, and the change of color wasn't exactly like the one that I liked, but, you know, I actually can go screen cap that from the stream. This is itself. I'm feeling this for near the end. You know? That's pretty cool. That looks like the scan of one of these faraway stars on your forehead. That was really cool.
It wraps back.
Whoa, and yeah, we came back. Very nice. Love it.
What if we go with a really large number? Are we going to get back into coin territory?
It'll be really fast, I guess. Yeah, let's check it out.
Flashlights warning.
And that's, I guess.
Yeah, no,
maybe
let's...
Maybe 1,000.
I'm thinking that maybe it's lower, would be like the image is decaying. And that may work better.
Okay.
I like what it does to my teeth, for instance.
Yeah.
So as long as we get back to red, because that red on my shirt was working really well. I don't want it to wrap back necessarily.
Yeah, so I think we gotta go more. I think even at 200, you were getting that red on your shirt just near the end. So I think you would want to go like, I don't know, 350 or something.
Let's do 250.
I need about 350.
250, I think we'll do. I'll take it. Do you want to play around some more?
Let's keep that one.
Okay.
I have like 10 minutes, so... Okay, so what can we do? Boop, 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 boop. We haven't tried much EQing. Well, we tried EQing yesterday, but now we got like a new setup. Should try some EQ-y stuff. We should also mix your video with the cramped EQ.
Yeah.
I think the mix stuff was working out real nice.
Let's get some of you back into the picture. Aria MP4, drop that in. Open the inserted, include all tracks from new file. Open the file inserted instead of the current one. That's what I want to do. And let's grab something else from you. The lights we already did. Yeah, let's do some Bon Jovi stuff here.
Okay.
Is that enough? That's only like 2 seconds. Let's get further back. Every translate. Yeah,
it's a show your face. There we go.
Export that. Close. This new file becomes the input. Where is my input? MP4. And then we will convert this and we will do what I really liked last time, which is to multiply by the next pixel. I think that worked well for us last time.
Yeah, that one was pretty awesome, yeah.
So the thing has been converted and we run this and that.
That does
the blocky background that I liked. But I think it worked better in not RGB, but in
UV.
Yes. Because we got all
keep,
that purple.
Keep the RGB too, or we can generate it one more time.
Oh, do you want to keep the RGB? Then I should run this. And then this, and that, and the other one. Huh, it didn't work so well this time.
Whoa, that's pretty nice.
It's just a bunch of green. I wonder what we can do with,
the
like,
thing you were doing. Last time, the thing you were doing, because I was going to say, like, okay, like, the point about the buffer is well taken, but I definitely remember when we started doing the modular thing, something did change. So it had an effect somehow. That's pretty, like, nice and subtle, too. I like that. I like the coloring of that. Oh, that's pretty amazing.
Anytime we go to this color, to this pixel format, we get purple and green.
And it gets more like psychedelic-y, yeah.
And what I learned is that this color model is you have one plane of luminance.
Yeah.
So brightness. And then you have blue and red. So we are...
And you know why?
No, I don't.
One, like the UV is when color TV was invented, but most people still had black and white TVs. You could broadcast that on the television, but then black and white TVs will interpret just kind of the lines, and then color TVs would be able to also decode the color.
Oh, that's interesting. But do you know why blue and red seem to make all the colors? Because that's odd to me. I would think that you would need three colors.
Well, so there's the way the image is constructed. Maybe you can look that up on the... Because basically, yeah, there's like a very kind of... Like, you know, if you see the R and G and B channels... There's, you know, one is like a basically a green and black, one is like red and black, and one is blue and black. But with the UV, you get kind of a yellowish one, and then you get kind of a light bluish one, and but they have less definition, and then you have one that has like all the kind of line edges, and together they combine to make the picture. But if you have a black and white TV, you can just take that channel with all the definition of the lines and see it.
I guess like this, right?
And
this. That's what I meant. I meant to show this.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So black and white will just pick up the top image, and then the other two will combine to get you the colors on a color TV.
That's amazing. But anyway, I do see the purple and green here, so that kind of makes sense.
So our values, cool. Yeah.
Not that I can explain this fully, but I see purple and green on the ends of the spectrum, so it kind of makes sense that we get those kinds of colors. So,
So I have an interesting experiment. We grab one of these videos. I think the last video, by the way, is a keeper. I really like that color.
Oh, you want to keep that?
But okay. Now we can, yeah. Now we can do some data math stuff to swoosh it around 90 degrees. So, you know, so that we get the other two ends of the spectrum, and that will confirm your theory and also give us a lot of cool contrasting juxtapositional material to work with.
Yeah, I converted the thing wrong. I used the wrong color space for the conversion. But now it should be good. Let's double check. I have Aria this. Oh, no, it doesn't look right.
Whoa. Well,
I will take it.
You can keep it just because.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should take it, but also what happened?
I messed up some command
line. Wait, what is the... Oh, okay.
And do we have a Aria... RGB? Did I lose that one? It's hard to keep track. Oh, no, I just called it output MP4. That's the one we want to keep. Where is output MP4? Here it is. Aria. And this is in
Oh, and youth. That's the right one, right?
Have two Arias YUV here. But never mind that. Still looking good.
Fine.
And let's change everywhere from this into RGB24 again. And division by zero, isn't this fun? So what was your idea again? I guess it's time for us to wrap up, but I forget what your idea was.
Oh, so the idea was like on that 2D plane of colors in the UV, right? We were seeing like the bottom left and the top right, and they were green and purple. So we can take that data and apply some math to them so that they are shifted 19 degrees and they end up at the other two corners of the color space.
I like that idea, but again, I think it's kind of cheating because then we are learning about the representation of the image as an image.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
True. Yeah, that's just the image processing. It's not like audio. Well, oh, is there a polarity flipping? That will be 180. It won't be 90. But, or, well, is there a phase? You can shift the phase by half a frame. Find the duration of a frame.
That's relatively straightforward because we know the dimensions and the depth of the bits. Or right. The depth of the pixels in terms of bits. Yeah, but...
So I guess the question is, does a phase shift in audio equal a shift in color in video? Or will something else happen?
I don't know, but I don't think we have time to explore that because it's time.
It's time to go, huh? I so don't want to go, but okay. You know what? Let's do the phase shift and then I'll go. 5 minutes.
Okay.
No chat, no nothing, no goodbyes. Okay, everybody, this is goodbye instead of a real goodbye. All right.
You want to do phase shift and you want to phase shift the input that we already have just to keep things simple.
Sure.
Then we can skip this. We can go to... Oh, no, we have to do this because we were using UV before. And now we're using RGB again. Then for the phase shift, I will place it here and I will want to see that. Oh, look at the time. Look at the time here. This is about 2 hours worth of audio so far. It is processing
at... How did that happen?
650 times real time. What happened is we took a video file and pretended that it was audio, but video is a lot more data than audio. Uh-huh. Ooh.
So the colors did shift. I don't know if other things also happened. But the colors did shift, and then that doesn't look half bad.
Let's skip it. And I would change this to be Aria Face. Okay. Now let's say your goodbyes.
Okay. All right, everybody. See you probably next week, same time, if you're down, Leandro, and if nothing weird happens. Oh, actually, next week, it's pretty much confirmed, but I think we will have Based in Beats, Flow from Based in Beats. I'll put the name of the channel in the chat with us. They code like Juice plugins. Check out the channel. It's pretty cool. I thought it'd be a cool person to talk to. And I thought to get that going. So that's what's happening next week and it should be fun. So if you have Juice questions, come on over. If you just have plugin ideas you want to pitch to somebody who makes them, come on over. If you want to do weird stuff, come on over.
When is that again?
Anything you want to pitch, Leandro? Next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday. Okay. And yes, I do have something very exciting coming up. So switch to the wrong camera. Right. This is me. So very exciting coming up this Friday. I have Saurin. I think that's how you pronounce his name. Saurin is the director of the Triforce Percent speedrun that happened on Summer Games Done Quick this year and helped raise over $250,000 to charity. It is a crazy art thing. It is not a speedrun. It is not a ROM hack. It is its own category of art form. It is the most amazing piece of art I have seen in a while. And the person who created it is joining us on Friday on my channel. And we'll talk about the technical aspects of the thing. So how you can take a song that you arranged in Reaper and put that in the N64. How you can inject arbitrary code into an N64 using controller inputs. And we'll look at the code. We'll look at some Blender models. It will be a lot of fun.
Awesome. Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Very excited to... And that's Friday at the normal time that you do stuff.
Exactly, yes.
Cool. Well, all right then, ladies and gentlemen. Adios. Godspeed. Live long and prosper.
Thanks for having me, Arya.
Yeah.
Thank you for watching the stream. You know how great it has been. Or maybe it sucked, and I am glad that you stuck with me. And so we'll all will be. But together for some more coding or talking or chilling. The next time I'll be streaming.